to the delivery of the extended audit service. This particular report covers the period from the 1st of November through to the 31st of December 2019. The report has actually concentrated on identifying any items of note that are escalated from the management reports, provides performance data related to the extended audit service, and identifies and would develop the technical base within the service. Members' attention is specifically drawn to section 3.2 on page 70, where a number of items of note are identified regarding work that we completed during this period. First item relates to an audit that we set up on the VAT processes and procedures in place, focusing specifically on whether or not there was adequate compliance with statutory regulations, but also focusing on the risk that were likely to be presented following the retirement of the VAT compliance officer, who was a fairly long-standing member of staff, and wanted to make sure there was effective sort of continuity arrangements in place. Conclusions drawn were that the processes will continue to provide separation duties and an adequate check regime, but there were a number of opportunities to strengthen and develop the controls put in place. The audit did result in 12 recommendations relating to those issues, and was all about improving the knowledge and understanding of VAT matters, improving the level of detail provided by all sources to inform VAT returns, and the procedures regarding the confirming the adequacy of COVID transactions. The second item I want to bring to attention relates to a fairly comprehensive piece of work that we undertook over the pension fund, looking at the Northern Local Government Pension Scheme collective asset pool. That's quite a mouthful. The audit was conducted basically to review the effectiveness of the arrangements, the government's arrangements that were proposed and will be put in place. This particular sort of asset pool relates to the work of the Manchester, West Yorkshire, Liverpool funds operating as a sort of a more collective. The review identified that good progress had been made in the development of the arrangements. The framework that was being put in place to demonstrate the effectiveness compliance with the principles of good practice and all the relevant guidelines that were out there. So members can take assurance from the fact that the things are looking pretty good in to this moment. The third item relates to the ERP system, which I sort of alluded to a little bit earlier in relation to providing members with an update on the outstanding recommendations that we made in relation to this. The next item I wanted to draw to members' attention was an item that was mentioned in my report to the previous audit committee, and again related to outstanding items, specifically in relation to a number of audits that have been conducted across the digital and information assurance arena. Updates are provided within the report. It's clear from the overall findings that whilst a lot of progress has been made, there are still a number of actions in relation to audits that include such things as GDPR compliance and information assurance. So members need to be aware of this and to, through myself, probably monitor the continued progress that has also been made. If we feel that the adequate progress isn't being made in due course, then it might be by yourself to invite the officers along and ask them direct questions in relation to those items. But as things stand, progress is being made. Section 3.3 on page 74, I draw members' attention to the attachment which basically summarises all of the internal audit activity for the period. This particular table sort of identifies the opinions provided in the audit reports and provides a RAG rating in relation to the current status for each of the entries. Section 3.4, also on page 74, I identify information relating to the performance of the audit service. You'll note that delivery of the audit plan at this particular moment in time is widely regarded as being on target. Feedback from clients remains very good, with all key actions identified by the report being agreed. And the satisfaction levels do remain high, which is very encouraging. Section 3.5 on page 75 identifies some of the continuing improvements that I'm making to the delivery of the technical service. You'll know from past reporting that this is an ongoing feature of how I like to deliver the service, and we don't like to sort of stand still and rest on our laurels. We're constantly challenging how we have to
content with that? Yeah. We thank you. I suppose the question we always have, and we always have had every occasion, is there anything more we as a committee can do to support your work and what you do in terms of your programme, in terms of the work of your staff and your colleagues, to make sure that you are taking, your recommendations are taken seriously, people help you, cooperate with you when you do your audits, and they actually follow up on the recommendations that you make. I think it's a perennial question, Adrian, it's not really.
I would say that I get more than adequate support and have done from this committee. I'm quite happy to escalate items to concerns for your attention that often involve you guys inviting officers along and chatting and put them on the spot, which is a healthy way of operating a committee of this sort. So I've never had any issues in relation to the support that you provide. I've never had any issues in relation to the support being provided. What I've been very expecting issues of aid and resourcing and type nature. That's the extent, as I've indicated previously, that I'm very happy with the arrangements that I'm being gained that we get from myself. I'm happy with the support that we do provide. So, but rest assured, should that change in any way, shape, or form, I'd be more than happy to step my head over and bring to your attention those conditions.
Super, thanks very much. Okay. Yep. So if we move on then, I think the next item is risk, isn't it? I think
it's the next item. It is the
corporate risk management update.
I shall introduce this report, but I do have Helen Turner, the...
Does everyone know Helen?
Councils of Risk.
Helen, do you want to come? Come forward. The lights don't go down as you come forward. So Helen, do you want to give people... Whoa! I'm sure someone could give you a spur there. But do you want to introduce yourself and let everybody know what you do?
Thank you. Yes, I'm Helen Turner. I'm the Council's Risk Continuity and Compliance Manager. I work with Mark and Chair, looking after the management and corralling of chief officers to keep the corporate risk register up to date.
And just the thing, how long have you been with us now?
I started on the 1st of October, so
we're four. Okay, so you're in a position to get a good view about what's going on. Yeah. Okay, great. There you go.
I'll bring to your attention. It's a regular report, has now become a regular report, this committee. It summarises the work that's been undertaken to update the corporate risk register and brings to the notice attention. Improvements and developments that are taking place across the limits of risk management environment. Members' attention is specifically drawn to section 3.6 of the report, where there are a number of risks that sit on the corporate risk register that have their scores adjusted to take account of either more mitigation that's been put in place in relation to the controls. There's one particular risk in relation to business continuity that had its score increased because we feel that the mitigations could be in place. Don't address the significant nature that this is presented. So, at 3.8 of the report, I identify areas where the risk of continuity manager has been undertaking more specific work in relation to health and safety and information management, two areas where there are significant risks and require some attention to help. 3.9 of the report reflects the new heat map that has been developed to assist in identifying changes in the scoring of the risks. It's attached as appendix, and it's thought that this will help members to better understand the changing sort of profiles of the risks that are included in the reports and on the registers. It is subject to ongoing development and improvement that we're happy to take on board, so that thoughts, views, suggestions that you as members may have. The only other thing to perhaps mention is the sort of the plans that are currently in play to invite you as a body to the risk workshop that we set up as a subgroup of this committee. The inbox will properties I need saving, you say?
Okay, that's super. Okay, so if Mark and Helen take questions between that, there is a reality, isn't that, writing something on a list of references just don't ever sort it out anything, did they? You know, it's doing stuff. And notwithstanding, there's some key things that you've identified. As you know, I've went through with that. I've got, and if anyone that's printed this out, it's all in black and white, not, so mine's not so great. But there should, in terms of risk appetite, so we know what the intrinsic risk is, we know how it's currently scored. What we should know is what is the score that the risk owner is aiming for. And what I see along here, so that's the third column, if you like, as you go along, is I'm seeing a lot of zeros, as though people haven't come back to you and told you, or the business one presumes, what it is that they're aiming for. And if we don't know what they're aiming for, we can't assess how effective the mitigation that they're saying they're putting in are, or whether they're working or not. So that seems to be a kind of massive omission at the moment. So could you tell us why that is? Is that you? Is that the director? What's going on?
Absolutely, Jay. It's one of the key questions that I asked of the risk owners, and one of the things that he's saying that it's vital to be included in the risk register and getting that better understanding for the organisation to understand its appetite. Unfortunately, I think it's a bit of a timing issue, and as well as we're starting, the information wasn't there beforehand, and it's certainly something that we're looking to build on and push people on and get them to set, as well as looking at whether these are the appropriate risks and the description of the risk is there. They were asked to do it just before Christmas Day, early December. Unfortunately,
they didn't bother, is what you meant. There was other things that they considered more important. So, just as a bit of a thing to help you, can we write as a committee to the Chief Exec asking to give us a response about why his chief officers don't believe they should have a target risk to aim for, so we can assess how well they're doing or not? Are we allowed to do that? Does that seem reasonable? They'll do a job? Yeah, okay, good. That's one thing we've agreed. Phil?
Yeah, I just wanted to ruin this piece of atmosphere. We had a discussion earlier about money and Council Whittingham raised an issue. I'm looking at page 20, let me figure up for you. Page 93, and you enjoy printing it out. I had to look at the computer to get the type size right. The section on financial resilience reads, failure to effectively manage changes in the way the council is funded could lead to poor decisions on service reductions, unplanned efficiency, and in-year overspends, resulting in the council being unable to deliver priority services to vulnerable communities. So I think what was began to be discussed earlier was the email we all had from the LGA chair on Friday or Saturday, which provided an LGA calculation which they hedged around with many qualifications to say this was an exemplification, but it was based on their judgment that might not be right and lots of things to be taken into account. Yet it was very much hedged around. I think I sent a copy to share over the weekend. But essentially it was picking up the issue of the fair funding, and it was looking at the money for adult care, over 65s, and younger people's care, and it was suggesting a distribution of growth or reduction in funding to local councils based on a calculation that the LGA had done. Now, they did say it might not be accurate, and they were working on it. But that might have set.
Right.
Since the LGA is run by the Conservatives, if I'm right, and the chair was a Conservative, then it struck me as right to try and investigate this further. And when I cut through the children's services budget is under pressure because of care costs and young people being sent to various places elsewhere, and knowing how much target there is for adult services to try and manage their budget to stay within a total, which we were discussing at the school committee and all that. If that was an accurate projection, it raised all sorts of troubles. If it was not accurate, I think Councillor Lewis was saying earlier, to my left here, that there'd been some statement today that might throw some light on the matter. Come across that. But the initial point was to say that if we didn't have an accurate picture for our financial resilience, asking our officers to get a target when the rug's been pulled under from everyone's feet, if the projections are right, would be a problem. I hedge that round a lot serious and not, because I'm cautious.
And I'm sure the answer to that is yes. However, or yes, but. These are the risks that, and this is Mark referenced the panel that we put together. So we as panel of this committee meet and we look at what we think the current risks are. And we also, then we have a discussion with the senior management team in terms of how they view risk. So in that way, we come to the risk scrutiny. So that's the first point. And then, of course, there's the whole issue of scaring, what's our risk appetite and so on and so forth. And what are we currently doing about that? This tends to focus, so it should focus, on stuff that we can do. Because we can't necessarily predetermine what the government may or may not do, but there are certain things that we as a council can do. And it tends to focus on what actions should we be taking with regards to those risks. So I would certainly invite you along to our next session that Mark is organising. I go slightly, yeah, anyway, we'll talk about that when we get the panel together. So that would be good. So we'll have a person from the Labour Dems, which will be good, and I'm sure someone from the Labour Party will come along too, which would be great. For now though, we've asked about the making sure we've got a target risk, so we know what we're aiming for. The other thing I'm not altogether sure about, because we looked at who decides the scoring. So we've now put in a matrix that people can see how to do scoring. Who assures us and the people that put this together that scoring is correct, and it's not just being used, for instance, as a way to, you know, up the ante to try and get money, ooh, look at the risk, to have the union more money, but this is being done properly, fairly, and consistently in terms of these key corporate risks that we've identified.
So,
Jeff,
some of that is, if I'm wrong, to challenge you on scrutinise some of the content and challenge the Scalers and directors as to why they're putting that score based on the information that they're putting on in terms of the existing mitigation controls and the planned actions. Also tying it into other performance reporting, whether it be internal audit reports, etc., and making sure that they are singing from the same hymn sheet and that presenting a joint picture. As you say, we've got the scoring definitions, risk identification and scoring should be done as a group exercise, and that is the guidance that I would give to anybody. It shouldn't just be one person's view swaying and skewing things. And whenever I talk to people in the guidance, it is about bringing them back to that scoring chart. There is a little bit of fiddle in the air, is this a four, is this a three? But each time I say, well, actually, does it reflect what's on the scoring chart? So that we can do some comparison and reflect what's a full impact in this area is the same in a different area. That is, as I say, is quite a lot wrong. What I would also say is that part of the piece of work I've got coming for the next few months is to look at the risk management strategy and look at the scoring and say, actually, does this reflect reflect where we see those boundaries and those lines. So it's a five, this is a four, this, and I've got some of the views out there. Working group that we talked about, so yeah, obviously the level is correct.
So again, just so it's unclear, your role, in your role, you are empowered to challenge a director who might put their finger in the air and decide, oops, this month I want it to look good, and next month I want it to look less so good, or someone's going to challenge me on what I'm doing to actually improve. So you are empowered to challenge that, and if you thought there was anything that wasn't right, you're going to speak to Mark and to me or to us or the chief executive or whoever you can speak to, yes? And that's very, everyone understands that, and that's very clear. Okay, that's good. Thank you. Yes, Jo.
In harvesting this data, and as you've gone forward on the creation of the heat map, is there anything that alarming you? Are there any trends to the risk, whether they be financial or otherwise? And at this stage, would you feel that there is anything that you really feel we need to focus on with regard to a given area that might be showing up?
I think, I come from the local authority, and I would say that actually a lot of the risks are familiar to me. There's nothing that has left out particularly unusual or missing from here. It is one of the things that we're looking ahead to, doing some horizon scanning and timing of the new council plan for 2020 and beyond. Actually, we need to have a refresh of some of this, and actually just some of the focus of these risks need to change and adapt as the organisation is moving on. So at this stage, there's nothing that looms out at this point.
Any more questions? No. In that case, Mark, Helen, thank you very much. You picked up that
note data, right from me?
Yes.
Good. Okay. Excellent, thank you. All right. Is the next one spend freeze programme? No PO, no pay. Is that right? Okay, right. Are you going to introduce it?
Yes, I'll introduce you to
you. All
right,
away you go.
Good evening, Chair, good evening, members and colleagues. This is a joint report by the Director of Finance and the Head of Government myself. For those who don't know me, I'm Keith Patterson, Head of Government.
Keith, sorry, just before
you
start, could you tell me you don't work for Sherry?
No.
Which is really weird. Sorry, there's a joint report between.
Yes.
Okay.
So just for clarity, procurement sits in delivery services and payment sits within finance. So payments and procurement are not in the same function. So this is a joint report, and it brings progress to the previous reports that we submitted back in November. Obviously the first part of the report deals with what we call the spend freeze. I think it's more of a spend lock really than a spend freeze, because spenders continue to go on as we continue the business. So it is more of a spend lock than a spend freeze, I think. So sections up to 3.8 deal with the background, but section 4 deals with the spend lock itself. We can report that some work was done on reviewing a number of purchase orders to understand how the spend lock was working. So 607 purchase orders were reviewed, and 81 purchase order approvals were included in the review. What resulted was that 465 purchase order data was returned by officers to clarify the reason for the spend. And you may get to see that the table of information is on the next page. So some of the analysis was that there were instances of non-compliance, but these were being addressed directly by with individual purchase order approvers, their manager and SLT. And just referring to the table itself, Within the other categories, 16 items represented 75% of the costs. All these items were either essential for things like public health or highways. There were a number of retrospective orders wrapped up in those totals as well. So clearly there was no real anything that could be done about a retrospective order because the spend had already gone. So that's the spend lock bit. If the chair wishes, I can go straight into an OPO and OPA, or we can just take some questions on the spend lock.
Has anyone got any questions on the spend freeze lock review? It certainly sounded like it was something else when it was announced in the paper. I know that, but you know, things were so grim, we had to spend freeze, and this is what was going to happen, what wasn't going to happen. So it doesn't kind of sound as like that. All those people are worried about whether they're going to get the care package and all that. It doesn't seem as though that's what's happened. It sounds to me like you start off filtering the POs, realise you've got so many that you've added it back down to the people who originally meant to have reviewed the POs in the first place. Is that fair?
Yeah, I think that's pretty much the case.
Which after something that was, you know, launched with such fanfare, it's a bit sort of low-key, isn't it? I do hope nobody was in the situation I was in, which was looking for a care package with the Star team. But my father, speaking to the social workers in the hospital who were reviewing that, to be told, yes, we have the email today about the spending freeze. So I do hope no one else was in that situation where they thought this is what was coming through, and it wasn't. And that's the danger of some of these sort of big announcements, you know, blah, 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 not good, losing your money, you've got to do a freeze. And actually, whilst it might be good, you know, sound-wise, it's not great for those people at the other end supposed to be trying to receive their services. So I've made that point to whoever decides what's going to do, what press releases the council's going to send out or otherwise. Okay, so let's move on to the next bit then. Yeah.
Can I
just make a comment
there? Of course you can. Just back to what you said a little bit in terms of pass the ownership back to the people who are spending to decide whether it's
whether they were right to spend it or not.
That was always in place. So when we actually looked at it in the first place, what we said is CMT, Corporate Management Team, who are the people who are responsible for reviewing the spend. What we said was you need to decide whether this spend is critical or not. So all the spending will come to myself in advance and for me to sign it off to say we can spend it or not. So what we said is this is your job. You're accountable to decide whether that spending is within the remit of the spend freeze, whatever you want to call it, or not. And what we've done, so that's happened and that's still been happening. What we have got to make sure that we can give the assurance that's actually happening is, as Keith mentioned, involvement one. So there is a team who are actually reviewing those purchase orders. So even though the managers have to determine whether they should spend it, there is then another review. So that's it. Those 607 purchase orders were reviewed by somebody else. And of those purchase orders, we picked those out, and we of those 607, 465 were sent back and said, we don't know whether this is within the critical spend freeze guidance or not. You need to tell us if it is and why it isn't, why it isn't. So it is being reviewed, but it's just not, it's being reviewed after the event.
All right, the second part.
Yes, so moving on to OPO and OPA. So under 5.2, we've done a breakdown of the freestanding invoices that were mentioned in the previous report. And I think what will strike members straight away is that in the previous report we reported that there was approximately, it was 9,271 transactions which we allocated as freestanding. So the first thing I think that will strike members is that when we've done this report further now to another few months over to the 31st of December, the numbers seem to have gone down. A 8327. And this is because, following further research, we were able to identify that a number of transactions which we believe to have been freestanding were actually being generated through the Matrix agency contract, were actually purchase orders were being generated electronically. So they've been removed from the total. So the current balance that we can record is currently 8327. So that takes the period from the 1st of April to the 31st of December. So wrapped up in there, we've got some services which we can clearly identify because of the way the batching system works in the payment system. But we've also got a large amount of transactions in there, 3,511, that sort of belong to all the departments. And in order to allocate services or departments to those that are going to have to be analysed on an individual transaction basis. We've also, you might recall that we also reported some information around retrospective purchase orders, and what we've done is some further analysis on that, which also breaks down the services. We can see that there are some services which seem to use RPOs a lot more significantly than others, and in fact we started to do some work with these services. In addition, we've also completed our workshop, our training program. So we trained 155 officers with the last training session on the 17th of December. I would remark that of those that registered to attend, 41 didn't turn up. So we're doing some mock-up work during February.
They weren't all from delivery, sorry. They weren't all from delivery, were they?
They weren't all from delivery, Chair, no. One thing I would add is that we just conducted some further analysis just today. I've had some information back from one of the reports that we generated, which will indicate that last week 310 purchase orders were raised, only 9 of those were retrospective. So we think that there's some evidence coming through. I don't want to paint a glorious picture, but we do think there's some evidence that what we've done so far is starting to take effect.
Okay. Yep. Is that okay?
That's a change.
Okay. Kath, you picked this all up and run with it over the months. Is there anything you want to, any points you want to make or any concerns you've still got around this?
The last figure that you gave was it's gone down. I think that probably because people are starting to do their job.
Yes.
I say. And I think at the last board and risk meeting and other conversations I've had with Cher, as I said to her, it's very difficult for her to do her job if everybody below doesn't do theirs. So I think a combination of kicking arms and a better IT system might concentrate people's minds into doing the job that they should be doing that they're actually going for.
I think there's another element to that as well, which is performance management in terms of, I suppose that's what we meant by K&A, but in terms of performance management, that people are, it is part of your job if you want to spend taxpayers' money on buying stuff. There is a procedure that you have to go through to make sure that that money is needed and you've got the best possible value for that money, because it's council taxpayers' money. Yeah, it's not a business, it's taxpayers' money. People have no choice whether they pay it or not. Yeah. So to make sure that we're actually delivering that and got that discipline in mind is, as you point out, the key part of somebody's job.
Well, it's educating employees and not doing something else, but staff to realise that it's not monopoly money, that it does exist in people's pockets, and all the employees of the Wirral Council. If I was working for the Wirral Council, then my tax, I'm spending my money, and so the community take ownership that they're spending the money that they generate as well, and to be careful with it.
Absolutely, and the key point for me has always been that people have no choice. We are one of the few organisations that can just go to the people and say, this is what we want. You have no choice whether you go fences or, I don't know, oldie or little or test beds. You can make your choice about where you go. And those companies can determine what they want to do because it's based on people's choice. But where they spend their money, discretion. They have no discretion about whether they give us the money or not. Stuart.
Looking at the table of 5.2, children's services, the 3,280, invoice analysis. So I'm just wondering about the process, because obviously we can talk about purchase of children's services, the purchase of care placements or about children's adults. I'd be interested in how slick the processes are. To get either the child or the individual into an appropriate care setting as quickly as possible.
Okay, I think, are you suggesting that you think 3,218 purchase orders? I think you're asking the veracity of that. Is that an indication that there's no discipline in place in children's services? Or are we talking about no?
I'm not questioning no lack of discipline or anything like that.
What
I'm saying is, in children's services and adults, we're purchasing care packages and care replacements. We're taking, if you take a child into care. So I'll be interested in whether the processes are slick enough. To identify care needs and get the appropriate authorisation from the decision maker and raising the appropriate invoice? Or is this a case of we just need to get things more quickly?
Okay.
We'll address that later.
Again, I'm going to avoid the obvious one. We're in the council for a little while, perhaps you know. Go on, Keith.
Thank you for the question, Councillor. I believe these processes really are more cultural, so these kind of payments processes have been going on for a long time. So when we introduced the No Beyond the Pay programme, it seems to have not happened in certain services. So there is a process in place. What I understand is that the invoices are received into children's services directly, and they create the records on an Excel spreadsheet, and they are sent to payments and paid directly into the payment system from that spreadsheet. So there is a process in place, and I don't know whether our colleagues from Audit can confirm any checks that have been done on that process itself. But there is a process in place. It's just not the right process.
Okay. So it's always a balance between, as Stuart was saying, making sure we get the right services, we procure the right services, and that we procure them get value for money, and we can do them in a speedy way. That's always the case. That does not, I don't believe, mean that people should develop their own sort of, off systems. For a start, as soon as you start talking about spreadsheets, the potential to get numbers wrong in spreadsheets is pretty serious. So, what I'd like to happen is perhaps if people can go away off the back of this and find out exactly what is going on, and to see if we could get those processes. Now, if it is too bureaucratic, and everyone will tell you that procurement is too bureaucratic, this whole business about having to do a purchase order, get three quotes, is outrageous. People will say that, will always say that. But we need someone with them taking a mature view to say, are the processes reasonable? We expect people to comply with them. If the processes are not reasonable, you don't just not comply. What you do is you comply, raise the issue, and then you improve the system. So can I ask people to take that away, please?
Yeah, Chair, just to give you something for the assurance I'm with it. So we do know what's happening, because Pete said it's exactly what's happening really. The invoice is coming to children, somebody queues them in, we've got a group that's actually looking at this and looking at how we can change all the processes already. It's taken a while. We are actually, we're starting to unravel everything, and we are working through it. The issue is it just takes a long time, and it's difficult with people's capacity as well. So this particular process, to unravel this, instead of the people and children inputting the invoice, so there is a manual intervention there, as you say, in terms of the spreadsheet. Their change in process is they need to input the purchase order. When the invoices come through, then they go straight through to the payments team. The issue there at the moment is the payments team then will have to key in 3,200 invoices that they haven't had to key in before. So the children's people are just switching what they do. Instead of keying in an invoice, they're keying the purchase order. So there's no, if you like, there's no change for them. It's in the payments team. So what we're doing is we're having a look as to how we could run that process through to make sure that, how we could change what they do to make sure they adhere to the process. But also that we don't stop the whole payments not being paid at the same time. So we have got this group, we are looking through it, we are working through it, we've unraveled it. It's just taking a bit of time to work through, that's